Purnamidaha Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate.
Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Brahman, the Absolute, is complete. Because he is complete, all emanations from him, such as the phenomenal world and living beings, are also complete. Beingness produced by the complete is also complete in itself. And because he is complete, although so many complete beings emanate from him, he remains the undiminished complete balance. Within every human being exists a source of energy, consciousness, intelligence, love, and enlightenment, an inexhaustible divine well. We can draw nourishment from it without limit. Some call it the collective unconscious. Others call it God. The holy Vedas of India call it Brahman. You can call it Tao or Nibbana or whatever you like. What you call it doesn't make much difference. But when you feel lonely, separated, or incomplete, it's not because this well has dried up, but because you have forgotten how to reach its waters. To solve the problems of life and attain liberation, you need to rediscover and reclaim the tools and methods needed to reach the nourishing source. Then your wisdom and strength will be as timeless and inexhaustible as the well that nourishes them. So that's what we're doing here. We're giving the tools, we're giving the means of reaching the completeness within, in the heart. We call it Brahman because we're following the Vedas. Others may call it by different names, but everyone, when they're asked to point to themselves, indicate their heart. So the heart is the seat of the self, self with a capital S. And this is the aim of all self-realization processes. However, in many cases, the processes identify the methods with the result. And they say, once you attain perfection in meditation, or once you attain perfection in hatha yoga asanas, or once you attain perfection in this or that or the other technique, that's enlightenment. No. Let's not confuse the finger pointing to the moon with the moon itself. Many techniques can put you in a position where it's very easy to jump to a state of enlightenment. But if you don't know how to recognize that state, and even more importantly, to remain in that state, you will lose it. And this happens to us again and again. We have this experience of attaining, more or less by accident or by good fortune, and then losing that attainment. Because of ignorance, because of laziness, not following the process, not keeping up the practice, or whatever. So this yoga system, Devānanda-Samādhi yoga, is a framework. It's not a dogma, it's not a religion, it's not a discipline. It's a framework for a complete yoga practice. Purnam means complete. That brings the complete human being, all seven chakras, because ecstasy or enlightenment can be experienced in all areas of human beingness, to the highest energy state, samadhi, or complete enlightenment, that enlightenment once gained, which can never be lost. Self-realization, realization of Brahman, the solution to all problems. Because once you attain complete enlightenment, then there's no fall down. There's no forgetting. What has been lost has been found and can never be lost again. That's the advantage of this complete yoga system. Most teachings only concentrate on one area of human life. The tantrikas are only doing sex. The yogis are only doing asanas. The bhaktas are only in the heart trying to develop love. And the mantra yogis are chanting and chanting and chanting. The meditators are sitting there and then trying to deny everything else and only meditate and thinking that will bring them to the goal. But what happens? Even if they reach the goal, because they're weak in other areas, they fall down. The only way to remain in that state without forgetting, without losing it, is to be strong in all areas of life so nothing can pull you down. You won't have any weak links in the chain of the chakras. So Devananda-Samādhi yoga is developed out of an experience I had of orgasm in all seven chakras. Simultaneous orgasm with emotional reciprocation from the Supreme, from the Omkar, from the Brahman in the Sahasra chakra. This experience proved that my theory was correct. It's similar to a path realization in Buddhism, but with all chakras activated and aligned and connected with the source. And this is my attempt to understand and explain this experience first to myself and then to help others to share this benefit. So sectarian religious teachings or teachings that build up a wall between us and them, between self and others, or between our method and others' method, between our God and others' gods, they all eventually fail. They have a beginning and an end. But the actual truth is open, and it's for all, and can never end because it never had a beginning. That's what we're teaching. Like I said, it's not a dogma, it's not a religion, it's a framework. It's a way of understanding, and any process, any method can fit in it. We don't deny anything. We say all methods are good in their proper relationship, in their proper place, so that the entire being can become enlightened. That's the point. So now we're just beginning this series. It's going to be quite an extensive series, I think. I don't see going beyond this teaching. This is it. This is the ultimate. I never said that before, did I? So it's interesting that before we even start the real series, this is still just the preliminaries, not even the pre-preliminaries. People are sending questions, and they're quite good ones also. So we're going to begin by looking at these questions. Here's one. You claim to be a Buddhist, but now you changed your name again and you're teaching yoga from the Vedas? Are you a Buddhist or a Hindu? Well, first of all, when in Rome, do as the Romans do, okay? When I was in Sri Lanka and I was an ordained monk, I went by a Buddhist name. Now I'm in India and I'm in a community practicing Vedic teachings or teachings derived from the Vedas, or actually a spontaneous enlightenment, which is being explained by using concepts from the Vedas, to put it properly. My guru, my master, Ramana Maharshi, is a case of spontaneous enlightenment. He's an original. He's not a copy. He's not an imitation. He didn't follow anybody. It just happened to him. And then later on, he came across Vedic books and Vedic teachers, and they gave him the vocabulary. They gave him the framework of knowledge that he could express his enlightenment. And so he expressed it in terms of his culture, which is South Indian Tamil Shaivite. So he expressed it in those terms, in terms of Advaita Vedanta and others, yoga and so on. That's natural. But what he expressed was unique to himself alone. And similarly, each of us is going to have to find our own path. And as we go from one teaching to another, from one teacher to another, from one culture to another, one country to another, in our journey, in our path, we change our name and form. It's only natural. So now I have a name and form that's befitting my current status and environment. It's not a big deal. Anyone who travels will understand this. It's only the people who are the chickens who stay at home. They can't understand. Don't you just have one name forever? No, everybody has many names. When you're a child, your mama has a pet name for you. Huh? Your friends might call you something else. And later on, when you grow up, maybe you change your name, either through marriage or because of choice. So it's no big deal to change a label. The being is the same. The person indicated by that label has not changed. Well, actually, I've changed quite a bit. Anyone who has known me for some time will tell you I'm a very different person now. And that's due to the mercy of my guru. I'll be quite honest with you. Without guru, you can never really get off the ground in spiritual life. So, guru tattva is an integral part of this teaching. So, anyway, regarding the question, I never claimed to be a Buddhist, just like I never claimed to be a Hindu. To me, these are both just labels, and they're concepts that are illusory. They're simply abstractions. They're simply words. Buddha wasn't a Buddhist, just like Jesus wasn't a Christian. Just like Krishna wasn't a Hindu. Where did this word Hindu come from anyway? Nobody really knows. But the best guess is that it was a pejorative term that came from the Persian invaders of India when they were stuck at the river Sindhu. And so with the Persian accent, it became Hindus. Ah, those Hindus on the other side of the river. So it was actually kind of a slang name, kind of a bad name that they called their enemies. So so then the people of India adopted this and started calling themselves Hindus, which to me is a supremely ignorant thing to do. So actually, the name of the culture is Vedic culture because it's based on the Vedas, or Sanatan Dharma, because it's based on the eternal truth. It's not based on some books. It's not some dogma. It's not some religion. It's not some sectarian thing. But anyone who investigates it will find that it's the truth. It's very scientific. So I'm not a Buddhist. I'm not a Hindu. I was never a Christian, even when I lived in America and I was going to church and stuff like that. I couldn't identify with any of these groups, and I still don't identify even with my guru's association or organization. I don't call myself a member of this group or that group or any group, because groups are also abstractions. Groups are also illusory. Groups also have a beginning and an end. But the truth exists eternally. So, following the completion of my previous spiritual teaching mission based on Christian consciousness, in 2012 I went to Sri Lanka and I was ordained as a Buddhist monk. I wanted access to the realized monks. They're hard to find. They're hard to reach. An ordinary person would never be able to reach my teacher, Jnanananda. And I wanted to realize the confidential teachings of the Buddha, the ones that are only given to monks. So I had to become a monk. Just like when I was studying the Vedas, I had to become initiated. I had to earn this sacred thread, the Brahminical initiation. Why? So I would have access to the secret mantras, the secret teachings, and I would be accepted by the best schools, the Brahminical schools. So I went to Sri Lanka, I practiced the Buddha's teaching, and I attained all four paths. So there were a lot of lessons I learned from that experience, but I'll stick to the main ones. What's known as Buddhism, quote unquote, today has very little to do with Buddha's original teaching. It's become a religion, a sectarian organization based on commentaries of the original Buddha suttas. So in other words, it's derivative, it's not original. It's not the eternal truth that the Buddha was talking about and trying to point to, the finger pointing at the moon, right? It's not the moon. They've gotten all hung up on the finger. I'll give them the finger. But lately it's become a very churchy kind of thing where people go to the temple and they offer puja, just like a Hindu temple, to a statue of the Buddha. So the Buddha never authorized these statues. During his lifetime, he prohibited it staunchly. So we don't really know what Buddha looked like. He appeared in Nepal, and then he taught in what is now parts of India. In those days, it was just all Vedic culture, different little provincial kingdoms. There was no empire of India. That's a myth. India was never a big empire. The people who wrote Mahabharata wanted to give the impression that India was a big empire, and now it's in decline due to foreign invasions and stuff like that. But India never had a need because it was totally decentralized. Every village practically could grow or manufacture everything needed, all the necessities of life. And human culture, as a friend of mine pointed out yesterday, has become more and more about unnecessary things. Huh? This internet, this camera that I'm using, all unnecessary for life. You can't eat cameras. You can't eat bandwidth. You can't make a house. I don't know, maybe you could make a house out of dead computers or something. But these are not necessities of life. Money is not a necessity of life. Having a position in some organization is not a necessity of life. These are all artificial things. So life, human civilization, and consciousness have now become more about unnecessary things, abstractions, phony labels, simply words, you know, like the president. Well, what is the president? The president is simply a word for a position in an organization. And organizations aren't real because they're simply agreements on paper that people agree that some fictitious entity is real. And I remember there was a story in World War II. There were some American prisoners of war. And to keep up morale, they started playing a game where they had an imaginary dog. Let's say his name was Spot. So to entertain themselves and keep up their spirits, they started playing all kinds of funny games and saying, look, here comes Spot. Oh, what's he doing? Oh, he's jumping on my lap. Oh, no, he's wagging his tail and I'm petting him and like this, right? So it was a harmless game. But after some time, one day, they started actually seeing the dog. At that point, they decided, okay, enough of this. This is getting too far out, too crazy. But doesn't it happen all the time? People will believe in something and they'll affirm the existence of that belief to the point where it becomes real. I think it was Hitler's propaganda minister, Goebbels, who said, if you repeat a lie often enough, it becomes the truth, in the sense that perception is reality. People start to perceive it, even if it is not. So this is what happens with spiritual teachings. People repeat the same mistakes over and over and over again until they become the dogma, they become the creed, they become the catechism of some religion. And then, of course, the actual truth is lost. So Buddha appeared, Gautama Buddha appeared in this Vedic culture, the wonderful Vedic culture that was so strong and because of its decentralization. And There nevertheless were several problems: the caste society, the addiction to positivism and so on, the objectification of these abstract entities in the form of statues and temples and so on, and puja to them and all of this kind of nonsense. So, in other words, the Vedic culture was the context within which the Buddha appeared and fashioned his teaching. Why? Because he was trying to correct the misunderstandings according to his self-realization, his enlightenment. So now, if you go back and watch our earlier videos, which I certainly hope you've done, otherwise you're going to miss a great deal here. Context sets meaning. For example, if you have a word, take the word up, for example. The word up has like 27 different definitions in the unabridged dictionary. 27 definitions for the word up. Well, what does the word mean? How do you decide? Well, you hear a sentence, and by the sentence, by the context, you determine which definition is appropriate. Fill up the glass. Well, in that case, up means into a position, condition, or state of fullness or completion. Yes, I read the dictionary a lot. Right? Or put up the cereal after you finish with it. In that case, up means away. Put away the cereal. Or I went up to the store. Up means in or into another place. You see, there are all these different senses of the word up. How do you decide? By the context. So that means the meaning of Buddha's teaching cannot be understood outside of its natural context, which is Vedic culture. Let that sink in for a minute. So one of the greatest tragedies in history was when the Brahmins agitated to kick Buddhism out of India. Buddhism was practically eliminated from India by the slaughter of millions of innocent Buddhists, one of the greatest crimes of all history. So by doing this, Buddhism was forced out of India into other countries which did not have Vedic culture as a background. For example, Tibet or China. And as a result, it lost its natural context and it became subject to interpretation by the meanings inherent in these other contexts. So what happened was the original teaching got lost, the original meaning got lost, and other meanings were overlaid on it according to the contexts or cultures in which the Buddhist teaching was being propagated. So for those who say, we have the original teaching of the Buddha, you probably don't, because you're in a Buddhist culture in Myanmar, in Sri Lanka, in Thailand, in Tibet, in China, in Malaysia. Those who are Buddhists became Buddhists without first learning the Vedic culture. And so there's no way they could understand the original meaning. I'm sorry. It's just not possible. Why? Because Buddhism's been taken out of its original context. So it's lost its original meaning. Ergo facto sum. Therefore, I was very fortunate to have accepted Srila Prabhupada as my Adi Guru, my first real guru. He taught me Vedic culture. All his students who paid any attention at all got a deep grounding in Vedic culture, from how to put on your underwear, how to take a bath, how to chant mantras. But most of them didn't listen. Most of them didn't pay attention. For example, Srila Prabhupada taught that when you chant mantra, you should sit in a proper yogic position. And there's even a joke, sit properly, among devotees, isn't it? But they don't. They stand up against the wall, or they walk up and down, or they sit in some odd position, not proper yogic position at all. And so what happens? The spine is not in alignment. Concentration cannot grow past a certain very mental stage. The mind wanders, and the effects of the mantra are minimal. So anyway, I was very fortunate to serve his teaching and participate in his community from 1967 to 1988. I learned Sanskrit, Vedas, performed Vedic sadhana and puja, and I got a very good grounding in Vedic culture. So when I encountered the Buddha's teaching later on, I could immediately see how the way the Buddha's teaching was based on Vedic culture and to correct many of the misunderstandings that were endemic in Vedic culture at that time, and mostly still today also. So in my view, the Buddha's teaching is not separate from Vedic culture. It's like an extension of Vedic culture to correct its insufficiencies and flaws. Because after all, both the Vedas and the Buddha's goal is awakening, enlightenment, moksha, liberation, nibbana. Nibbana is nothing but moksha, same thing. The same thing that's called liberation in Vedanta is called nibbana in Buddhism. So there are different methods of reaching it, but that's a whole different discussion. The goal is the same. The Vedic path is primarily positivist philosophy, while the Buddha taught by via negativa. If you don't understand these terms, please look them up in a good philosophical source. Wikipedia will do. Via positiva, via negativa. Very important terms in philosophy, which most Westerners don't understand because all they've ever heard is via positiva, positivism. So the Buddha went by the negative path, neti-neti. This is not it, this is not it, this is not it. There's a wonderful sutra called the Mula Pariyaya Sutta, the root sequence. And this is about, I get ecstatic when I think about it, the original thought in the mind and how we project it on reality to create a false overlay on our experience. And this becomes such a habit that it goes on unconsciously. And nobody realizes that it's going on. And because of that, we don't ever see the actual reality. We only see our interpretation of it, which is based on the thought, I. So without dropping this thought, I, the mind can never be stilled. And without stilling the mind, one cannot know what is the reality. Be still and know that I am God. So, positivism and negativism, or Vedic culture and the Buddha's teaching, are actually complementary. Via positiva and via negativa aren't contradictory, they're complementary. And one can be used in certain situations, the other is best for other situations. For example, the first line of the invocation of Ishopanishad, Aung Purnam Ada Purnam Idam Purnat Purnam Udachite, is nicely explained by the Vedas, positivism, but not by Buddhism. But the second line, Purnasya Purnam Adaya Purnam Eva Vashishite, cannot be explained by the Vedic tradition such as it is today. However, it's very nicely explained by Buddha's teaching. How's that? Well, okay, It's very easy through positivism to understand how the Aum, the Brahman, or the root of all being, can emanate so many beings and so many existences. Huh? But it's not easy to understand how, even though emanating so many beings and existences, it remains completely full. It's not diminished in the slightest. How is that possible? Because we experience every day that when something with being has something taken away from it, it becomes diminished, isn't it? And this is true of everything that has being. Time alone is enough to diminish and destroy anything with being. So how is it possible for God to emanate the entire creation and not be diminished? And the answer is emptiness. Emptiness is the conclusion of the via negativa. Complete nothingness without even the chance of any beingness arising, because there's no process of becoming. There's no space, no time, no matter, no energy, no nothing. Of course, this is one of the fundamental realizations on the Buddha's path. So if nothingness or emptiness cannot be diminished, it is the only candidate to fit the description of Brahman. And indeed, if you meditate on emptiness, if you meditate on nothingness, if you realize shunyata, then the light of Brahman automatically will manifest within. This is one of the most wonderful experiences you can have. And it's the second path. So anyway, this is because the limitations of positivism and negativism, both have limitations. Therefore, both are necessary for complete self-realization. So, this is very hard to understand intellectually. Don't even try. Don't waste your time. Because the intellect is not equipped to handle complementaries. But through experience, through meditation, it's very easy to understand. So, similarly, the dualism of mainstream Vedic and Western culture and the monism of Shankara and most interpretations of Buddhism are both extreme and therefore incomplete positions. The answer is found not in a compromise and not in a synthesis. This is a cosmic incongruity which demands a totally radical new solution. And that is called achintya bheda bheda tattva. Achintya means inconceivable, bheda means different, and abheda means non-different. Tattva means truth or philosophical principle. So the bheda bheda tattva is that it is not monism nor dualism that is the truth, but somehow a combination of both. They're both true and they're neither of them are true. See, logic fails, words fail. But this can very easily be experienced by vichara, or inquiry into the self. And this is what this teaching is actually about. And the problem is, of course, that most of us are not fit. Most of us are not able to perform vichara. If we were, you could sit down and get the ultimate solution in 5 minutes. I can explain it to you in one sentence. But, in fact, I just did a little while ago. But you won't get it. You can't realize it. It becomes words only, just a symbol of enlightenment. So this is explained very nicely in the Mundaka Upanishad. The sacred word, Aum, is called the bow. The arrow is the being, and Brahman is its target. Brahman shall be pierced by him whose attention does not swerve. Then he will become one with Brahman as the arrow becomes one with the target whence it has pierced him. Take, my friend, this bow, this great weapon of Upanishad. Place veneration on it as the whetted arrow. Stretch it with the thought fixed on the nature of that, Brahman. That very imperishable is the target, my friend. Strike it. So in other words, when the arrow pierces the target, are they one or are they still different? In the beginning, the target is one, the arrow is something else. But then when the arrow hits the target and penetrates it, they're inseparable. So are they one or are they different? Well, it just depends on how you look at it. They are in a new state, which is not exactly defined by either oneness or difference. And the same is true of the self-realized being when he attains union with Brahman. I explained it to my friend the other day in the restaurant. I said, it's just like when a man and a woman are in union, in sexual union, and they have orgasm. The energies of both are combined, and one has penetrated the other. But yet, depending on how you look at it, there's still two individuals there. They're individuals, but they're interpenetrating. So are they one or different? Well, there's no word for what they are. The word is ecstasy. The word is orgasm. The word is enlightenment. Orgasm in the sex chakra is the equivalent of ecstatic love in the heart chakra or enlightenment in the sixth chakra. It's all ecstasy. It's all a function of the seventh chakra, which is beyond all. Neither this nor that, and yet somehow both. These things all have to be experienced to be understood. They can't be understood by words. So, similarly, when the individual being becomes self-realized, he still maintains his individuality. Just like all the enlightened masters of all time, each one has his own individual style. It's not like they all become the same. Ramana is different from Osho, and Osho is different from Krishnamurti, and he's different from Gurdjieff, and they're all different. Yet, they all realize the same truth. How is that possible? Well, that's why we have to meditate. That's why we have to do sadhana. That's why we have to contemplate these things for a long time to understand how it's possible. So this is when people, naive people with no background, talk about enlightenment as being one with God. Well, you need to consider really what those words mean. Don't take it very simplistically. It's a deep, deep truth that takes a long time to understand. So, this is the confusion behind the questioner's question. That why have I appeared to switch paths? Why has the Buddhist Dharmasar become suddenly the Vedantist Saraswati? Devananda. By the way, don't say Devananda. It's Devananda, okay? Devananda means something completely different. So how is this possible? And still he's the same person. You see, the questioner is confused because he doesn't understand that both the Buddhist teaching and the Vedantic teachings are aiming at the same experience. And he hasn't had that experience, so he doesn't know. And he can't imagine how anybody could have that experience, but it's quite possible. You're looking at him. So all this is simply external. When I was a neophyte Vedic disciple, I wore certain robes and performed certain activities and so on, appropriate to that position. When I was working in the computer field, I wore a suit. A leisure suit, but still a suit. When I was a monk in Sri Lanka, I wore Buddhist robes. Now I'm in India, in a Vedic culture, so I wear Vedic robes. It's not a big deal. Name and form are very superficial. The essence is what matters, and the essence is behind everything. So now that I'm actually realized and experienced, I don't really follow any particular path. Yeah, Ramana is my guru, and I'm certainly under his shelter, but he's very, very open and broad-minded. He doesn't impose any particular discipline. He says, realize the self, realize the I am, inquire into who am I. That's all. Whatever you are, whoever you are, inquire into it and find out. It's an experience. It's not an idea. And it's certainly not words, so it can't be made into a dogma. It's very intelligent. So, for example, people get it wrong all the time. I was in a shop the other night purchasing some idli, and I was doing my mantra. I was in ecstasy. I was seeing light. I was like, just in the corner, back up against the wall with my eyes closed, just blissing out. And this young man was explaining to this girl who was checking him out that he was a doctor in London, or he is a doctor in London. He's doing research into using meditation to heal brain damage in multiple sclerosis patients. To me, this is like using an interstellar spaceship to go down to the corner to buy some beer. You know? This is not the purpose of meditation, although meditation may have some positive influence in any case, in all cases. Still, that's not really what meditation is for. He used to be a Buddhist monk, but he failed. He didn't attain enlightenment. So now he's trying to use meditation as a grocery cart to get some material benefits. See, this is stupid. This is just plain idiot. Nassim Taleb calls him IYI, intelligent yet idiots. And why is that? Their heart is not in the game. They don't have any skin in the game. Huh? It's all up here. It's all just ideas and words. So they don't get any realization. They have too many weak links in the chain, too many chakras that are asleep or repressed. So that's why in our teaching, we try to develop all the chakras simultaneously. Practice at 7 methods. The methods can be anything you want. Huh? If you don't like hatha yoga, for example, you can do calisthenics or weightlifting or running or dancing. But it has to be, there has to be some kind of physical exercise to keep you in condition. Just like there has to be some love in your heart, some love for something or someone, preferably a form of God. But you have to be in love to open the heart, to open that chakra. Otherwise, you won't have your full energy. You won't have your full intelligence at your disposal. How can you become fully self-realized? We're talking about the biggest thing there is. So anyway, Devānanda-Samādhi yoga is about opening all the chakras to their maximum energy. So this fellow, this poor guy, who was a monk for years in a monastery in the West, who daily visits the temple of the enlightened one. Huh? You can't understand this. To me, this is pathetic. And the only reason it can happen is that people don't understand this framework, that these chakras have all to be developed. If only one is missing, if only one is dead or asleep, you can't attain. And that's why 99% of people in spiritual life don't ever get anywhere. They just go around and around in circles. So this is typical. they get caught up in externals and they miss the actual point. So anyway, similarly, the people who see me only in terms of externals are missing the point, and they'll never get the point. And I feel very sorry for them, but what can I do? It's their choice to remain ignorant and to focus on the externals instead of the essence. Because if you had any brains, if you had any heart, if you had any intense instinct, you could see